The carbon cycle is definitely changing. The main contributor is fossil fuel, and humans have also altered the carbon cycles in different ways, with deforestation, wood harvest, and land use change. My name is Camille Wall. I'm a PhD, first year PhD student at Lund University. And my thesis focuses on the states and changes in Swedish primary forest. You can look at how the carbon cycle has changed at different scale. I think one of the most famous way to do it, or like most common knowledge, is looking at atmospheric gases that contain carbon. But you can also see the impact of a change in carbon cycle by looking at ecosystems that store carbon. So carbon is present in the atmosphere, but it's also stored in oceans and in terrestrial ecosystem. In latter, it's mostly in forest.
I'm Anne-Marie Eckes-Shepard. I am a research scientist, and I work on simulating forest responses to climate change. Trying to figure out when a forest turns from a sink into a source, that is quite easy to do in a model, because you're tracking all the carbon pools. So you're tracking the amount of carbon in the tree and in the soil. You're tracking the amount of carbon that comes in, that comes out. It's actually a bit more challenging for the scientists on the ground. But these values, these on the ground values, are really important for the models, because our models can tell us anything, but they should obviously tell us the right things. And for that, we need the data to constrain it.
It might be surprising for some, but it's actually very hard to know what changes in the carbon cycle come from land use and what are due to global environmental change like climate change. And that's something I'm going to address. So in my research project, I look at the change in carbon storage in primary forests, which are forests that have had little to no land use. And what we're going to do is revisit old NFI inventory plots, measure them again, and the results should show us how the carbon stocks have changed over time due to global environmental change only.
Sometimes to create models, we need to generate data. We need to have the right data to feed these models. And we can go to the field and get the data from there, but sometimes it's more convenient to try a more precise approach. We are bringing soil samples into the lab where we have the right equipment, and we also have perfectly controlled conditions. In this case, we're analyzing soil samples. We look at how bacteria and fungi respond to different temperatures. So we know that microbial communities, they transform litter, they eat litter and transform it to different forms of carbon. And this carbon can be stabilized into soils, as you can see these more darker particles in the soils. But then these communities, they also respire. They send back CO2, or carbon that was stored into soils is transformed into CO2 and sent back to the atmosphere. So depending on how much carbon is stabilized or sent to the atmosphere or respired, we'll have a negative or a positive feedback on climate change. Here we can see the data from the experiment. We can see bacterial growth, fungal growth, and respiration, how they perform at different temperatures. And then using modeling, we can estimate what would have been the contribution to carbon cycling in the field. We can run simulations like this one, and this would be the carbon emissions in the field. In this case, it's just the role of microbial communities, but we can see how they will respond if climate increases temperature 1, 2, 3 degrees. And then this is just the contribution of microbes. But then there are other researchers, other groups that are studying, for instance, what is the effect of climate change on vegetation. And then we can also use complex models to put all these different elements in the ecosystem together to get better estimates on how climate change will affect carbon cycling and the amount of carbon that is stored in our ecosystems.